This episode of Brains Matter is sponsored by Swinburne Astronomy Online. For further details on online astronomy degrees, please visit http://astronomy.swin.edu.au/sao. Welcome to Brains Matter, a podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hi everyone, and welcome to episode 75 of Brains Matter. Today we'll be talking about first stellar generations. Yes, the first stars that formed after the Big Bang. We'll also have pin of the episode and some listener feedback. On today's episode, I've got Dr. Richard Stancliffe. I'm in his office at Monash University, but he's not actually originally from Monash. So can you tell us a little bit about your background,
Richard? Yes. So for my sins, I'm a Pommy. I grew up in England.
So you can't play cricket?
Don't tell Kevin Peterson that. Yeah, don't worry. I'm not looking forward to the next Ashes series. Yeah, so I grew up in England. I did my undergraduate in Oxford, where I studied physics. And I took a major option in astrophysics final year, because ever since I was young I'd always gone outside, stared up at the skies and got, ooh, what's all that up there? And that's kind of, you know, cold winter nights I would be sitting out in the rabbit hutch in the back garden with a pair of binoculars. So it's nice to have been able to follow that through. So when I finished my undergraduate degree, I moved to Cambridge to do my PhD, where I studied stellar evolution with Chris Tau. Then when I finished that, I continued on in Cambridge for another 3 years as a postdoc, continuing working on stellar evolution, particularly low metallicity stars, which is what we'll be talking about later on. And after about 3 years there, I put in an application for some money to the Australian Research Council, and here I am at Monash.
And you suddenly appeared. You mentioned that we're here to talk about first stellar generations. Can you tell the listeners what that means?
Okay, so you take a look at the world around you today. There are many different materials, the carbon that you and I are made up from, the oxygen that we breathe, nitrogen in the air. There's a whole bunch of stuff out there.
So the 92 stable elements and the God knows how many unstable elements.
You know them better than I do, yeah. When the universe was formed, you didn't have all those elements. Right after the Big Bang, produces hydrogen, helium, and a little bit of lithium, a bit of deuterium as well, but mostly it's about 75% hydrogen and 25% helium.
Is that helium originally formed in the post-Big Bang era, or does it come from the hydrogen?
No, well, it's immediately from the post-Big Bang era, but it's formed, bits of it will have been formed from the hydrogen. So you start off, as the universe begins to cool down, your quarks can combine to form protons and neutrons. The protons and neutrons can combine to form limited amounts of nuclei. So anyway, we've started off a situation where we've just essentially got hydrogen and helium. And in one of those great simplifications that science has, and astronomy has probably the worst, the universe is divided into three things: hydrogen, helium, and metals. So everything that is not hydrogen and helium, an astronomer will generally refer to as metal. Be that lithium, beryllium, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, all the way up to iron and the heavies. So, as I said before, you know, we're surrounded by elements that are not hydrogen and helium, or not predominantly hydrogen and helium. So we're interested in where those things have come from. And we know that hydrogen and helium can be fused together to form heavier elements inside stars. And what we're interested in with the first stellar generations is, well, in stars like our own sun, the metals contribute to the processes that go on inside those stars. So nuclear burning can proceed through something called the CNO cycle, where the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen act as a catalyst to help convert the hydrogen into helium in the center of the sun. The first stellar generations can't do that because they don't have the carbon, the nitrogen, and the oxygen. So
what happens with them? They get hotter and hotter, and then...
So, yeah, we're interested in these stars because we think that they should behave differently to the generations of stars that we observe today. As you say, yeah, they end up being hotter. And the metals... Let's go back one step. Before we form the stars, you have a great big cloud of gas. And somehow that gas has got to condense down in order to form those stars. Now, it turns out in order to do that, you have to be able to cool certain bits of the cloud down so that the collapse can stop, because what's keeping the cloud supported is all these more atoms banging into one another.
Effectively, the heat
It's pressure support. If you manage to cool down a section of the gas, bits of the cloud can start to collapse and gravity can take over until you've compacted it down enough that nuclear reactions can start, and then you can get the pressure support back. So the question is, how do you cool that gas? Now, a generation, if the gas cloud includes metals, the metals can help to cool it. If you don't have those metals...
Such as the first generation.
Such as in the first generation, you don't have the same cooling mechanism. So one of the questions that interests people is, what masses of star can you actually form if you don't have these cooling mechanisms? Because in the universes we observe, the local universe, so bits of our galaxy... Predominantly, the stars that form are all of low mass, so a little bit smaller than the Sun. And generally, you form fewer and fewer more massive stars. Which kind of makes sense, in a way. If you go to the lower metallicity environments, we don't have the same route. So how am I going to... Can I form my low mass stars anymore? Can I cool my bits of my cloud down enough that they can actually start to condense and form the lower mass stars? That's an open question. There are people involved who work on doing simulations of this, and they find, or some of them find, that you can't make the low mass stars. You can't make things that are about the same mass as the Sun. You can only make really big ones, so 100 times the mass of the Sun. And stars like that live very quickly. Stars like that evolve very quickly. They live their lives a lot faster than the smaller stars. They're bigger. They're hotter in the center, so they burn through their fuel faster.
So they go through their stellar life cycles
much more rapidly. So something like the Sun will live for 10 billion years or more. A star of 100 solar masses may live for only 10 million years or so. So there's a question of, you know, what can we form? Maybe we can only form big stars. Maybe we can form... Some other simulations suggested maybe we can form some of the smaller stars. And some of us kind of felt like a bit of a compromise and said, well, we think we'll find a lot that are big and a lot that are small.
Not
much in between. So people are still working on that. And so we would hope, you know, maybe we can find some evidence to point to what's really going on there. Now, the problem that you have there, as I was saying before, is massive stars live quickly. When we think the first stars formed quite some time ago, so... Current estimates of the age of the universe suggest it's 13, 14 billion years old. The first stars may have formed anywhere, say, maybe hundreds of millions of years after the Big Bang, up to maybe about a billion years.
Okay.
So there's been a whole run of time, 12 or more billion years, for any stars that were formed in that first generation to have lived, possibly to have died, and returned the material that they might have made into
follow-up generations.
Yeah, into the follow-up generations, which is good for us because it means you and I can be here having this conversation. Ideally, you'd like to go, okay, here's my telescope, let's go point it at that star over there. But you can't do that. These stars are probably long since gone.
Yeah, so the likelihood, especially with optical telescopes, given the distances we can see with the speed of light, it would be very difficult to see something which is more than 12 billion years old.
Yeah, so, I mean, usually you'd say, okay, well, we go to look at things at higher and higher redshifts. So, you know, as you know, that the further things away, the more redshifted the light from them appears because of the expansion of the universe.
Yep, so for the listeners, the redshifting is when something is moving away from you. And so you can think of an ambulance siren when it's moving towards you, it sounds like it's a higher pitch, so it's blue shifting. And if it's moving away from you, it sounds like a lower pitch, which is equivalent to redshifting.
There are branches of astronomy that are looking to find the the objects at higher and higher redshifts, because we're looking back. As we look to higher redshift, we're looking further back in time.
Yeah.
And so the further back in time we can look, because it takes the light so long to reach us, you know, we can see earlier and earlier and earlier on. And I think the record now for highest redshifts for the sun object is around about Z of 6 or so. Now we think that the first stars would have been even further back than that, maybe as far as we measure redshifts in terms of a parameter Z.
So what does each number in Z represent?
That's unfortunately not a simple... I was looking this up because I knew you would ask me about this. It's not a simple one-to-one relation. I can't say that Z equals something is so far back in time.
So it's almost like... is it logarithmic, like the Richter scale?
It's even worse than that. It's wrapped up in the models. I think you can almost scale it directly. Sort of say a Z of 10 would be when the universe was about a tenth the current age of the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because like I said, we want to find something that is back at, that maybe was around 1 billion years after the Big Bang. So we're trying to look back 12 or more billion years.
Mm-hmm.
So that's at a Z of around about 10 maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And we just can't see that far back yet, unfortunately.
Is it possible to do that with other type of telescopes, such as radio telescopes?
Most of the high redshift, some of the high redshift work is done with the radio telescopes, but still, we're only getting to maybe 6, I think, is the record. There was one that claimed, I think, they got to around about 10, but that wasn't a very concrete determination from what I remember.
Mm.
You know, we can't see these stars.
Let's take a little bit of a break from the interview just for a minute and go to the listener of the episode. And today's listener of the episode is Fabry Kramer from England. Thanks for joining the Brains Matter Facebook group, Fabry. Now back to the interview with Dr. Stancliffe.
The question then becomes, well, can we see the results of them?
Mm-hmm.
Can we see things, can we observe things in the universe today that we can look at and say, that there must have come or should have come from the first stellar generations. So one thing I should talk actually a little bit about is...
the way I'm hearing it is it's kind of like forensic science almost.
Yeah, that's...
you look at the after effect of, say, an explosion, a crater on the ground, and from that you need to determine the size of the explosive compound, where it was situated, how fast it was moving, because what you see is the result... but you don't actually see the explosive itself, because by the time you've come in, it's after the fact.
Yeah, forensics actually is a very good analogy for this. Stellar archaeology is another term that I think could be applied. So yeah, well, how do we go about doing that? So as I was saying before, the first stellar generations don't have any metal in them. The trick then becomes, okay, let's go out. Let's point our telescope at the sky and try and find stars that don't have much of a metal content. And particularly the metal, in this case, that we're usually interested in is iron. Because in massive stars anyway, the iron is the end point of the nuclear energy generation process. Mm-hmm. So I can fuse hydrogen into helium. I can fuse helium into carbon and oxygen. Mm-hmm. I can start fusing the carbon and oxygen together. But eventually, I get to the point where I fuse things into iron.
And then it becomes too much energy required.
Yeah. Iron is the most stable nucleus. It's got the most tightly bound together.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't actually get energy out of it by trying, you can't take two iron atoms and go, I'll try and smash them together and hope to get more energy out when you bind them together. So once you get the iron inside a star, it can't, it no longer has any more fuel left. It's burnt itself out. And at that point, the star can no longer support itself.
It starts to collapse.
And we get a supernova. Mm-hmm. So these layers of material are compressing down on the core, and suddenly get compressed down so tightly that everything rebounds back up and out blows your star, and that's how you get the metal returned into space. What astronomers do is say, okay, well, let's go out, let's look for evidence of iron in stars,
mm-hmm.
and let's see if we can find the most iron-poor stars. Get our telescope, we take spectra of the stars and we measure the lines,
mm-hmm.
The spectral lines, the lines of iron, we can work out how much there is. And what we think is happening is that the less iron we've got,
The older the star.
The older the stellar generation must have been.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we're lucky in this regard. I said before that we think maybe the first stellar generation consisted mostly of massive stars.
Mm-hmm.
We're lucky that that's not the case in the current universe, because the lower mass stars are longer lived, so they stay around longer.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can find some of these older lower mass stars that maybe have just been polluted once or twice by the earliest generations, maybe we can look at them, look at the metal content in them, and say, see if we can learn something about those stars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the thumbprint from the criminal,
yeah.
To use your forensics analogy, and see if we can then work out what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's been a lot of effort in recent years. Survey teams have gone out and measured hundreds of thousands of stars looking for the most iron-poor objects we can find.
Mm-hmm.
And a particular interest in these stars are the other heavy elements that are there. So, for example, elements like europium, uranium, thorium, the really heavy ones here, mm-hmm. what we think probably came from these supernova explosions. These heavy elements are what are technically called R-process elements. And what that is not all the atomic nuclei that you can form are stable. Some of them will decay and throw off a positron, that's beta plus decay,
mm-hmm.
and they'll change from one nuclei to another. So in order to make some of these big nuclei, you have to add something to them.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, we think what's happening is you have a nuclear, relatively heavy nucleus, and you're adding neutrons to it. And not everything you form is stable. So maybe you add a neutron and the nucleus goes, I don't want to beat that. And it decays and forms something else. In the case of the R process, which elements you produce are a competition between how fast you can add the neutrons and how quickly they can decay into other nuclei.
So kind of like using a bucket to try and empty a boat which has got a hole in the bottom. So whoever wins is faster.
Yeah. So in the case of the R process, we think what we have is an environment which is very rich in neutrons. So mm-hmm. there's a lot of neutrons floating around. So the nucleus sits there and gets hit by a neutron. And decay to another isotope isn't necessarily an instantaneous process. Some of them are extremely fast, mm-hmm. some of them are quite slow. And we think in this case that what is happening is, whilst the nucleus is trying to make up its mind whether it should decay or not, another neutron comes along, whack.
Mm-hmm.
And so we make another nucleus. And so we call it the R process. The R stands for rapid, because we think the rate at which neutrons are being captured onto the nuclei is considerably quicker
mm-hmm.
than the decay process.
Mm-hmm.
In a very imaginative way, we have a situation that is the reverse, which we call the slow neutron process,
mm-hmm.
where we think that you capture a neutron, the nucleus has time to decay to whatever it thinks it wants to be before the next neutron comes along. Now that happens at a completely different type of star, which I'm quite happy to talk to you about some other time. So anyway, back to the R process. So we think that when a supernova explodes, there's a lot of neutrons flying around there, and there's the potential to form these R-process elements.
Mm-hmm.
So these heavy things, like I said, europium, thorium, uranium, that sort of stuff. The other good thing about these things is they have a lot of energy levels. So they're very... These nuclei have a lot of protons, so they have a lot of electrons associated with them.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can go off and observe the spectra of these isotopes, and when electrons make transitions between the different, the electrons sit in shells
mm-hmm.
in a shell structure around the nuclei, and when the electrons are moved from one shell to another, they absorb energy if they're receiving it. So we can go off and look at the spectrum because they have so many lines. It's easy to find lines in the system and measure
work out what elements are in it.
So you can work out what's there. So,
because that was something that I always used to wonder when I was little. People would say, well, that star has got this in it. And I would think, well, that's so far away. How can you figure out what's on it if you can't feel it, touch it?
Yeah. Atomic physics and measuring the spectra of, you know, working out something about scales you can't even see just by, literally by looking at it, just by observing the light that comes from it,
mm.
is... I remember sitting through my atomic physics lectures and learning about this stuff and just going, wow, that's mind-blowing. You know, you can learn something about something so small just by looking at it. That's
half a galaxy away.
And then you can go and do it in space as well. I mean, we're not just talking about looking at a heated up sample of material on the bench.
Yeah.
You're talking about doing this in space. This, that's pretty cool.
Thanks for listening to part one of the episode on First Stellar Generations with Dr. Richard Stancliffe. Listen to the next show where I'll have the conclusion to the interview. In the meantime, let's go to some listener feedback. Firstly, from Darren Osborne in Sydney, Australia, he comments on the interview with Dr. Orly Latham-Kaplan about stem cells and infertility. And Darren writes, really good episode. Gives a great outline on the topic. Thanks for that, Darren. And a lot of you have given some great suggestions on the website for science songs. So for those of you who haven't visited the website recently, I'm going to get together with Mark West from the Mr. Science Show and Ian Wolfe from Here's Why. Both of those shows are independent Australian science shows, so you can never have enough of great science. So listen to those if you don't already do so. And we're going to talk about scientific songs. So the one that pops to mind and one that the Mr. Science Show used to use for its theme song was She Blinded Me With Science by Thomas Dolby. So that's a good example there. So put your thinking hats on, come up with your list of suggestions and leave those comments on the website at www.brainsmatter.com. And I'll leave you with a quote from David Russell. We live in a Newtonian world of Einsteinian physics ruled by Frankenstein logic. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right-hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.